The advent of life on Earth is shrouded in mystery. We know certain things these days, but the picture is still woefully incomplete. However, there have been a number of interesting recent discoveries in the field of figuring out how life arose over the last few years, giving us a better understanding of abiogenesis, better than ever before. This research has been surprising in one way, but in another way not surprising. The surprise comes in its simplicity. There has been a tendency within science to assume that abiogenesis is difficult and requires very specific conditions, and just what those exact conditions were remains unknown, with different camps, some favoring deep sea vents, others beaches, and yet others hot springs. To illustrate this, a good example here is how RNA came to be. The hypotheses on just how that happened were numerous and varied, and often were novel, which is not good for the idea of life being common in the universe. One particularly interesting one was that the energy needed to get that process going came from the first abiogenesis being located on a radioactive beach. Radioactive decay is an energy source, and beaches are near water, and Earth in the early days had a lot more decaying uranium on its surface. But as it turns out, new research by Stephen Benner suggests that it was far more simple than that, and that random RNA is generated when water percolates through volcanic glasses. And that may be it. It may have been simpler than we thought. Another instance is the formation of cell walls, which also had many hypotheses on how it happened. But work done by Deemer and Damer has shown that to get a protocell, basically a lipid cell wall, it can happen in volcanic, remember the RNA volcanic glass, hot springs that repeatedly go through wet and dry cycles. This is particularly interesting because Earth isn't the only body in the solar system that could have had something like that going on. Early Mars fits the bill quite nicely, and Venus may very well have as well earlier in its history. And perhaps most surprisingly, very early on, this may have happened at Jupiter's moon Io as well. Again, it may have been simpler than we thought. And then there was the Miller-Urey experiment, where the conditions of early Earth were simulated as best they could when that was done in 1952. And they put in the chemicals needed for prebiotic chemistry, added in an energy source basically simulating lightning, and out came sugars, amino acids, and most of the building blocks of life. They were created readily and simply. In that case, it was definitely far simpler of a process than many had imagined. But there was always a huge question floating around in all of this that wasn't well answered, and was subject to repeated revision as new information came to light, just when abiogenesis happened. The problem there was that Earth really hasn't preserved much in the way of its earliest rock, meaning that fossil evidence is scant and usually limited to early microbial mats and zircon crystals that indirectly provide some evidence of early life. But those kinds of indicators are very situational and just give you an earliest we know of type of answer, rather than a definitive this is about exactly when it happened scenario. That has now changed. What was known was that life started early in the planet's history, very early. What wasn't known is how early it actually happened. Two aspects of this are unusual. The first is that very early Earth was not habitable. It was first molten, and then subject to constant bombardment by material left over from the solar system's formation. The other aspect was that no matter what happened, life arose on this planet the very first moment it possibly could. But when was that first moment? Well, one former showstopper was the late heavy bombardment. It was thought that life surely couldn't arise during that chaos, but it turns out from fossil evidence that it apparently did, right at the height of the bombardment. This may be telling because there are a number of possible scenarios here that could explain it. The first is that abiogenesis is very easy and gets going in a suitable environment almost immediately, even if there are asteroids falling everywhere. We don't yet know enough to say that is the case. And while if it were really easy, we'd probably know about it. We might even see it attempting to happen to this day, only to get snuffed out by our brand of life. Arise now and you get eaten. Arise first and you establish hegemony. But overall, the process is easy. Another scenario is that life isn't from here and was deposited here by a meteorite or some other mechanism of seeding from somewhere else in the solar system, perhaps Mars, or even some other star system in the sun's birth cluster, because back then we were still in that cluster in close proximity to other star systems that probably also had planets, comets, and asteroids. Another option is completely speculative, and there is no indicator whatsoever of this, but you could even play with ideas of life having been artificially seeded here. That also is plausible, but wholly without evidence. In the end, though, all we really know is that life is here. But just when that first happened was elusive given the sparse information we had. Researchers at the University of Bristol in England have changed this through studying genetics, however. Link to the new paper in the description below. By comparing modern organism genomes and employing a multidisciplinary approach, they were able to work back to an approximate date genetically to what is known as the last universal common ancestor, or LUCA for short. This is the organism that all life on Earth descends from, and it turns out to be way older than expected, 4.2 billion years, when this planet was only about 300 million years old. This was not expected. Most estimates were a good 400 million years after that, but it actually does fit with what we know today about Earth's habitability in those days. And the answer seems to be that it was habitable that early, but only barely, just marginally starting around 4.3 billion years ago, which may strengthen the case for some type of panspermia. We're talking really early for Earth here. Or that life hits like lightning, the very first chance it gets everywhere, that's even close to marginally suitable. The universe teems with microbial life indeed, if that is the case. Earth was also extremely different from what it is today back then. Abiogenesis would have happened in what would now be a toxic atmosphere, almost devoid of oxygen and wholly unsuitable for most surface life today. Earth was not Earth then in its atmosphere. It was for all intents and purposes an exoplanet. Might as well be as alien to us as standing on Mars without a spacesuit. We would not last long. The work in the paper involved what is known as a molecular clock. This allows a reasonably accurate way to estimate the rate at which mutations occur in a genome. And then, from that, you can work backwards and get a general feel of just when that particular organism diverged from whatever common ancestor it had with related organisms, but also what it was like to a certain degree. This is helped along by all life on Earth being related. We all come from the same origins, whether you're a human or a clam. We use the same amino acids with the same chirality or configuration, common chemistry, related genetics, and so on. But what LUCA actually was is another matter. But the study also shed some light on that. It appears that LUCA was a very primitive, on its face, the most primitive, prokaryote, a single-celled organism with no nucleus. Not really a surprise there, but it is confirmation of what was strongly suspected. It obviously wasn't based on oxygen. But there are still plenty of microbes that still aren't, and even some that oxygen is poisonous to. And they are the progeny of the earliest life on Earth. LUCA's metabolism probably produced acetate, something still figuring prominently in biology today. Nothing surprising here, except that this study, as happens in science so delightfully often, also produced another mystery. You'd think, as the first organism, LUCA would have been alone on this world. This does not appear to be the case, however. There apparently was something else here with it. It turns out LUCA had an immune system, albeit a primitive one, indicating that the viruses were already here as well. And given that LUCA was metabolizing and those waste products can be used by other life, it probably wasn't the only microbe for very long. Others could have emerged very rapidly from it. All of this comes together to say that not only does life emerge quickly somehow, an ecosystem emerges almost immediately with it. This has a major implication in astrobiology, because a single organism is one thing, an ecosystem appearing very rapidly is another, and indicates that evolution has been here since the start. But not only that, more importantly, natural selection. But this also involves a rather obscure hypothesis that may gain traction from this find. In the early 2000s, several papers advanced an idea termed the virus-first hypothesis. So ultimately the question is, which came first, cells or viruses? You'd think it was the cells. After all, what would a virus do without cells to infect? But it may not be that simple. Ultimately, it actually rests on the assumption that cells were first. But do we really know what the ancestors of the viruses were? Not really. We just know that for both life and viruses, it was some kind of replicating entity. And since viruses replicate in cells through infection, then, well, seems logical. Incidentally, that entity, which is more chemistry than biology, though it is termed an organism, is sometimes called the first common universal ancestor, or LUCA. And it's even more mysterious than LUCA. Very little is known about it, other than something like it seems to have been required before cellular life. All that is known is that it was non-cellular, chemical in nature, and allowed the translation of RNA molecules such that it leads to the production of proteins. Again, it's completely unclear how viruses fit into that, if at all. The thing is, unlike cellular life, virus genomes are all over the place in variation. And how all that plays into a first common universal ancestor or ancestors is unclear. But as far as which was first, the cells or the viruses, this references work by Kunin and Martin from 2006 that suggests that viruses just simply started out as self-replicating entities, something that's thought to have happened before life with RNA, and maybe even DNA, but that is more shrouded in mystery as to how that happened. So there may have been some kind of entirely chemical, universal common ancestor for both life and the viruses that happened at some point before the biological LUCA and perhaps LUCA appeared that gained increasing complexity and organization, but wasn't alive. It was molecules evolving, or perhaps better expressed as organizing. And RNA viruses are still with us, very much so. So it may simply be that simple replicating RNA molecules could have been the first viruses, capable of infecting cells, and had the ability to infect the first cells that appeared, LUCA, or maybe something earlier that we don't know about. It's even possible that this process continued and that the emergence of eukaryotic cells happened because their nucleus actually started out as an enveloped DNA virus setting up shop in a prokaryotic cell, and thus the leap happened, reducing one of the proposed great filters to no longer being a filter. Though it must be noted here that other recent research actually shows that particular leap from simple to complex life may have just been a matter of symbiosis instead of infection. So much remains unclear in this topic, and it may even be that the presence of viruses, especially if they predate cellular life, were much more important to abiogenesis itself than anyone imagined. We may not be here without the viruses, and they may have even driven evolution early on. This is creepy in a way totally separate from this research, just an observation of mine. So this would all imply that natural selection happened from the very start, survival of the fittest. LUCA only existed because it had a primitive immune system against what might have been a pre-existent predator. And that set the age-old war between cell and virus into play, sort of before the beginning of life. And that survival of the fittest is the common denominator of life in the universe. No viruses, no complex life, or maybe no life at all, which might constitute a kind of proto-solution to the Fermi paradox. Not there yet, we need to know a lot more, but getting there. But natural selection telescopes up, as we humans show, and can be tempered, but it's still going on. Maybe the universe is not actually a very nice place for any civilization, or even life within it, and it's all xenomorphs, predators, and Ellen Ripley out there. Might be a good night to revisit an alien or predator movie. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently apparently already existing in spooky season, and it's still a month away. Time travel indeed. There's been a number of cool but spooky stories in science lately. I like it. The spookier the science, the better. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.